Shall we start?
Yes, ma'am. Good evening, everyone. I'll be presenting a case of a 41-year-old male, Prashant Kumar, hailing from Electronic City, native of Orissa, working as a security guard in Bangalore since the past 3 years. The informant is himself and the patient history is reliable. He's a right-handed individual and was examined on 12th, that is today. He presented with the chief complaints of weakness of the left upper limb since 4 years, twitching of the left hand muscles since 3 years. Remember the history of presenting illness. Patient was in his usual state of health, performing his daily activities, when he initially noticed weakness of the ring and the little finger of the left arm.
What is his age?
41-year-old. Okay. He noticed weakness of the ring and little finger of the left arm. This weakness was noticed when he was changing the gear of the vehicle and he was trying to count numbers and notes. And this weakness was gradually progressive, such that he had difficulty also in buttoning and unbuttoning the shirt. And he had difficulty in lifting heavy objects from the ground that he was previously able to lift. And this weakness progressed over the past 1 year. Since 2 years, this weakness reached up till the point where he was having difficulty in lifting objects from the ground. However, since the past 2 years, this weakness has been static and has remained non-progressive. Currently, he is able to move his fingers and is able to comb the hair and lift his hand above the head in the left hand. 6 months after noticing the initial symptom of weakness in the ring and the little finger of the left arm, he also noticed weakness and thinning of the left hand. He noticed initially the thinning of the palmar surface in the region just below the ring and the little finger, and this weakness gradually progressed along the forearm. This progression, he says that in the forearm, he says one half of the forearm was involved in this point where he noticed the thinning of the lip. There was associated flaccidity or a feeling of looseness that the patient noticed while using the left upper lip. After the onset of the weakness, 6 months after the onset of the initial weakness, the patient had twitching of the muscles in the left upper limb, initially noticed in the forearm, and he says it's gradually involved all four limbs and at different points of time. However, he did not have any particular aggravating or relieving factors for this twitching. There is no history of weakness of the other limbs, such that he was able to use the right upper limb as well as both the lower limbs. During this period, the patient denied any sensory disturbances in the form of a Lermite sign, radicular pain, paresthesias or deboring paresthesias, and is able to appreciate clothes all over his body, and is also able to appreciate hot and cold while taking bath. There is no history. There is no history suggestive of any cranial nerve weakness, especially regarding the bulbar weakness, and there is also no history of any bowel bladder disturbance, so that he is able to sense initiate void urine with no fullness or dribbling of urine. There is no history of postprandial fullness, giddiness, retrograde ejaculation, or palpitation, suggestive of autonomic dysfunction. There is no history of fever, weight loss, or night sweats. Patient denies any memory disturbances or involuntary movements. Past history, the patient is not having any, there's no history of diabetes, tuberculosis, thyroid disorders, exposure to chemicals or radiations or chronic drug intake. During this period of the weakness that this patient had, 1 year ago, he was taken to a local government hospital there and he was said to have motor neuron disease and was given a short course of Riluzole for about 2 weeks. He has taken the tablets for 5 days, after which he has stopped the medicines because he felt the twitching increased after taking Riluzole. Family history is born out of a non-consanguineous marriage. There's no history of similar complaints in the family. After stopping riluzole, he was given vitamin E supplementations and has found no benefit or improvement of the symptoms with vitamin supplementation. Personal history, he consumes a mixed diet. The appetite is normal. Sleep and bowel habits have been regular. However, there is history of high-risk behavior that this patient has had. Summary, I have a 41-year-old gentleman with no previous premorbids, with high-risk behavior, presenting with an insidious onset and gradually progressive left-sided weakness involving the small muscles of the hand, wrist, as well as the forearm, associated with thinning of the similar regions, with no sensory, bulbar, or bowel bladder autonomic involvement. So differential diagnosis, it's a pure asymmetric motor weakness with involvement of the small muscles and predominantly in the ulnar nerve territory, because he has said the ring and the little finger, and progressive with asymmetrical involvement in the forearm as well. So I would like to consider neuroanatomical localization into the anterior horn cell because it is pure motor weakness. However, because there is asymmetrical involvement, thinking less in terms of that, and plexus and nerve can be other possibilities.
Okay, so we will analyze one by one. You said that this person's high-risk behavior will come to later. You said he noticed weakness of the left little finger and the ring finger. Was it weakness or thinness? You notice, because we use these two fingers very less. More so if it is on the left hand in a right-handed person. No? You said he's a right-handed person. And what was the real difficulty? Did he notice that this finger was not coming? Finger flexion was difficult or what? Because little finger, ring finger on the non-dominant hand is not that much involved in the functions of the hand. So what did he really notice when he was when he was trying to apply the brake, the fingers were not coming? Yeah?
Yes, ma'am. They were not moving. There was a lag in the using these two fingers. They are not moving.
Okay. So because you said that he could count the notes.
He was having difficulty in counting the notes. He was having difficulty in counting and counting numbers. When he was trying to count, he had difficulty in moving these two digits.
So difficulty in counting notes means it will point to opponents.
Opponents.
But a difficulty in combing all those things were not there. The finger was not thinned out. It was flyly hanging like that. Huh?
It was not flyly hanging. There was a lag when he was trying to move the finger. So it was moving less.
Who means extending or?
In flexion.
I want to know whether it was lumbricals or some long flexors or something else was involved.
Flexion, ma'am. It was in flexion. Flexion. It went into flexion. There was the finger went into palmar flexion.
It went into coil.
Coiling.
Oh, that is correct. So what he really noticed is he had a partial cloying. Partial cloying. Then it becomes more clear. Partial cloying you will definitely observe. So partial cloying, when you say it is very, very clear that long flexors are better. Only if the long flexors are better, cloying will happen. So lumbricals were weak. So when we call it as a partial cloying, when what is complete cloying, what is partial cloying, and people always ask the mechanisms of cloying for medical. So actually what our patient noticed is partial cloying of the left hand. That will be obvious because use of the left hand little finger, ring finger is very little. But cloying will be visible. So now I understand. So what the patient noticed is he had partial cloying when he had to extend the fingers. So that is what happened. And we call it as partial cloying if all the fingers are not involved. If only some of the fingers are involved, it is called partial cloying. It is not the completeness of the cloying. It is the completeness of the hand by which we call it as partial cloying or complete cloying. So your patient had a partial cloying. So you are correct. And partial cloying means lumbricals were weak and long fluxes were strong. And in any case, as you rightly said, we will have to start from the peripheral to center. So first, nobody wants to make a diagnosis of an anterior consult disease. That will be the last diagnosis. So a very young man coming with partial cloying involving the medial two fingers, you will have to rightly differentiate it from ulnar nerve, CAD1 root. Then as he said, you will go, before the root, you will go to the cord. In the cord, it will be the medial cord. So whether it is ulnar nerve or is it a medial cord or is it a CAD1 root or is it a intrinsic disease in the spinal cord like syrinx or spinal gliomas, and last will be degenerations. And a person with a high risk behavior, you can even expect a spinal granulomatous diseases, like because unusual sites become involved in infection pathology. And they are immune suppressed. So it can be tuberculosis, some other granulomatous disease can involve the spinal cord in that region when if he is immune compromised. We don't know if it's immune compromised, only the behavior he said was not all right. Okay. So how to differentiate? So now it is very clear it is a partial cloying clinically, apparently purely motor. But when you examine, it may have sensory. So that keeping it in mind, we will know what is ulnar nerve. So ulnar nerve will be sensory motor reflex. Always I tell, to differentiate all this, we put some titles, that is sensory, motor, reflex, and any unique features. Like that we put. So if it is ulnar nerve, it will be, of course, it will be the medial 1.5 fingers sensory. So sensory, motor, reflex, 1.5 fingers sensory. And it can extend into the distal 1/3 of the forearm on the medial side. So it is not two fingers, it is 1.5 fingers and extending to the lower 1/3 of the medial forearm, sensory. Motor will be, even though patient has developed a partial cloying involving the two fingers, when you examine, you might find that there is weakness of all the small muscles of the hand except the median innervated muscles. So clinically, it may be apparently looking like two fingers, but when you examine, you might find all the small muscles are involved other than the median nerve innervated muscles in the hand. That is motor. Reflex, finger flexion reflexes can be affected. And generally, no unique features, except that you may have to look for the thickening of the nerves. Because in some parts of our country, still Hansen's disease is the commonest cause for ulnar nerve palsy. So you will look for this sensory, motor, reflex, and then thickening of the nerves and patches in the body and look at thickening of other nerves and other features of Hansen's disease like nodules. You may find in the high-risk behavior patients, they develop special types of Hansen's disease, Lucio leprosy, or you have got Norwegian type of leprosy where there is mixed skin infection with the other skin infections like and clubbed with Hansen's can happen. Or you can have a scleroderma like picture and Hansen's, that is Lucio, when their immune system is very poor. So you look at the skin, you look at the nerves, and you look for other mixed skin infections like Norwegian type of scabies with Hansen's disease combined, all those things you will look for. So that is ulnar nerve neurologically, sensory motor reflex part and palpation of the nerve, we have finished. Then we will come to the medial cord. Medial cord means you supply, you have in addition to ulnar nerve, so all the features of ulnar nerve will be there. You will have medial root of median nerve and you will have medial pectoral nerve. So medial root of median nerve supplies the thenars also. Lateral root of median nerve supplies the forearm muscles of the median nerve. Whereas medial root of median nerve supplies the palm, small muscles. So in addition to ulnar nerve, you might find motor extending to the thenar as well as the pectoralis. So medial root of median nerve, medial pectoral nerve. And medial cutaneous nerve of the arm. So sensory will extend more proximal. So sensory will not be strictly 1.5 fingers. It will not be lower 1/3 of the forearm. It will extend more proximally. And motor will extend to the other small muscles and the pectoralis. And reflex, of course, finger flexion reflex. And you will not have any other special features except if the plexus or the cord is involved proximally, other features of paraspinal muscles may be there. If it is traumatic plexopathies, you might find paraspinal muscle thinning. That's a special feature indicating that there is avulsion. Otherwise, you do not find anything. So motor will be extending to the small muscles of the median nerve innervation and pectoralis. Sensory will extend to the forearm. Reflex, there is no speciality, that finger flexion reflex will be depressed and there are no other unique features. That is medial cord. Then we will go to CID1 root. If it is CID1 root, what is the sensory? Ulnar nerve is 1.5 fingers. Medial cord is extending to the upper arm, whereas CID1 root will be 2 fingers. So instead of ulnar nerve 1.5 fingers, CID1 root is 2 fingers and it will extend like the medial cord. It will extend along the medial part of the forearm and the upper arm. So it will resemble the medial cord. The sensory will be extending to the upper arm also. Then you will find that all the small muscles. So motor will also look like the medial cord. All the small muscles will be affected. CID1 root supplies thenar, hypothenar, intraosteal, lumbrical, everything. Then you might find Horner syndrome. That's a special feature. So sensory will be, unlike ulnar, it is 2 fingers. It extends up to the upper arm. Motor will be small muscles, but unlike the medial cord, it will not affect the pectorals. So medial cord will affect the pectorals also, whereas CID1 root will not affect the pectorals. It will affect only the small muscle, all the small muscles. And sometimes you might find a Horner syndrome. That's a special feature. That is CID1 root. Then we will go to syrinx. Or pseudo syrinx. So you can have syrinx or you can have pseudo syrinx. Both you can have. Pseudo syrinx happens in cervical compressive myelopathies and or intrinsic cord lesions like gliomas or granulomatous lesions. So how to suspect that CID1 root, syrinx, that typically involves the small muscles and generally it involves all the small muscles by the time you know it. But it can start patchily because it is antihonsural distribution. It can select some muscles and spare some muscles. By the time you see, it may be all the small muscles. And sensory will be, and depending on the extent of the pathology, it may extend a few segments above or below. Next, sensory will be dissociated. You know that it is the crossing spinothalamic tract that gets involved in intrinsic cord lesion. So all other conditions which you saw, medial cord, CID1 root, ulnar nerve, all modalities of sensations will go. Whereas in intrinsic syrinx-like lesion, you will find dissociated sensory loss. And in the area involved, there is reflex loss. You can have Horner's. So intrinsic cord lesion, one is small muscles. Sensory loss is dissociated small muscles and it can extend more. And dissociated sensory loss are unique features. You can have Horner. Motor, depending on the areas involved, it may extend a little more proximal or distal, depending on the stage you are seeing. So, point will be dissociated suspended anesthesia. Same thing can happen with tumors or granulomatous lesions in that area. So, that is how you have to differentiate. But this patient started in that area. And then he involved the medial forearm muscles, you said, no? Not the lateral forearm muscles. So that is medial forearm muscles is going in favor of an ulnar nerve pattern of motor. So that we will keep it. So extending to the medial forearm indicates ulnar nerve pattern, but it is purely motor that we'll keep in our mind. Sensory part is not helping us. Then it did not involve the proximal part, no? It did not involve the lateral part also.
No, ma'am.
It went on to involve the opposite upper limb. The same distribution. Was it in the same distribution?
Opposite upper limb weakness was there only in left arm and forearm. Only one hand. Other hand was normal. Yes.
Not involved.
Okay. Not.
So it is a purely motor, medial forearm and partial groin. So that we will keep it like that. Then you said that he noticed twitching. So twitching, first we want to know twitching, how to, for MD examination, you should know how to differentiate. One is what, when you call it as fasciculations, fibrillation, cramps, myokymia, I'm sure you know all these things. For those younger boys who may be there, fibrillation is denervation, supersensitivity of a single muscle fiber. So your muscle motor unit consists of several muscle fibers. And if one muscle fiber is disconnected from the motor end plate, the acetylcholine that will be released from the motor end plate, instead of confining itself to the neuromuscular junction, it will spread along the muscle membrane. So it is a denervation supersensitivity of a single muscle fiber to acetylcholine. Normally, because the motor end plate is there, it will be diffusing from the presynaptic region to the postsynaptic region. When it is disconnected, so it is will be focused at that site. But when it is disconnected, the acetylcholine is still released, but it will be diffusely spreading, not going to the postsynaptic region specifically. So that makes the muscle membrane jittery. So fibrillation is denervation, supersensitivity of a single muscle fiber to the chemical environment, that is acetylcholine. Usually fibrillation is not visible except in the tongue. Next is fasciculation. So when we call it as fasciculation, fasciculation is the visible twitching in any other body part other than the tongue. It's a fasciculation involved involuntary movement of a single motor unit, whereas fibrillation is a single muscle fiber. Fasciculation is a motor unit. And the PETA mechanism is haptic conduction through the terminal axon. So what happens, one motor unit is disconnected. That we call it as the sick motor neuron theory of McComas. So he says one motor neuron dies and one motor neuron has got a motor unit, the territory is distributed. And that what happens, there is a dying back phenomenon. When the motor neuron is dying, there is a dying back from distal to proximal due to reduced axoplasmic flow from that neuron. When the neuron is sick, that's a neuron is as such sick. So axoplasmic flow is poor. So the farthermost muscle fibers of that motor neuron become sick. So what happens? The motor unit, that one, the disease is in the motor neuron. And so the motor unit becomes sick. And it becomes sick from distal. So what happens is, the muscle fibers are getting activated anterograde and retrograde. Both ways, activity is normally taking place. When there is a retrograde transmission from the motor unit, suddenly the terminal axon will find that the axoplasmic flow is not there. So it blocks there. And it comes back, instead of going back to the cell body, retrograde axoplasmic transport to the cell body is lost. So this will go and come back through the same terminal axon. So fasciculation is spontaneous contraction of a motor unit due to haptic conduction through the terminal axon due to disconnection of the terminal axon. So cell body is sick. So it's what is sick is not the axon of the muscle fibers, the cell body is sick. So axoplasmic flow is slow. So distalmost part of the axon is not getting nutrition. And that axon is supplying all the muscle fibers of that motor unit. So there is a functional disconnection at the terminal axon. When there is a retrograde axoplasmic flow, both anterograde and retrograde is there normally. When the retrograde axoplasmic flow is happening, it gets suddenly stuck at the terminal axon where disease axoplasmic flow has caused lack of nutrition and degeneration, even though disease is proximal. So these are all otherwise called central distal axonopathy syndromes. The term is central distal axonopathy syndrome. So this will go, and after a point, it cannot progress. So it will come back through the pathway through which it went. That is why it is called spontaneous contraction of the muscle fibers of single motor unit due to haptic conduction through the terminal axon. So it's an haptic conduction through the terminal axon that produces fasciculation. What is myokymia? Myokymia is conduction by contiguity, acute denervation like Guillain-Barré syndrome or metabolic insults, viral infections, where one muscle fiber by contiguity with another muscle fiber, it is a membrane transmission. One membrane is sick and so contiguous muscle fibers become activated. So it's a vermiform contraction of contiguous muscle fibers happens in acute denervation. That is myokymia. What is a cramp? Cramp is a painful shortening, and you have got benign cramps and you have got pathological cramps, otherwise called contractures. Contractures are electrically silent, cramps are electrically active. So cramps happen due to unaccustomed exertion in a normal person or normal exertion in a sick person. That is cramp. It's an energy deprived state of the muscle due to unaccustomed exertion in a normal person. That is, suddenly we start doing that 100 meters running competition or something like that. We are not used to that. So there is a energy failure, energy deprived state. So you get into painful contraction that all of us would have experienced when we climb mountains for our temples and like that. Long distance when you are doing, you'll get the cramp. Whereas even at the rest, if you are getting, it is a pathology. This can be seen in muscle disease, endovascular disease, steroid disorders, various kinds of diseases of the muscle, inflammatory muscle disease, all those things you get. But when you put the EMG needle, you find it as electrically active. Then you use the term cramp. If it is electrically silent, you call it as contracture. Because electrically silent one is always pathological. There is no benign contracture. Whereas benign cramps are there. Benign contracture is not there. It is electrically silent. It is always pathological. Myocardial disease, all those conditions, it is electrically silent. So now we know so this looks like a fasciculation because it is not seen in the tongue, it is seen in the limbs. In the limbs, fibrillations will not be visible. It is spontaneous contraction of multiple muscle fibers, probably it's a motor unit. Now, so it looks like a contracture, it is chronic, it's not acute like myokymia, there is no pain, so it's not a cramp or a contracture. So now we should ask, for exam purpose, what is a benign fasciculation? And what is a pathological fasciculation? That's the next question you will face if you get a short case in your exam. Benign fasciculations are more subjective. Usually medical students, when they enter the wards for the first time and see the serious diseases, they complain about many students do that. Even I am sure you also might be seeing students coming and complaining. So benign fasciculations are subjective. Usually it is in one site only. They will keep on telling it is over my left biceps or some area. So it is localized and there is no wasting. There is no reflex change. And you will not find, if you do the EMG, you will find large clusters. You can still see it is triggered by stress and stress-related biogenic amine release. And you might find large clusters of spontaneous discharges more than 5, and the baseline EMG will be normal. Spontaneous activity in clusters of more than 4 and normal EMG. So it is subjective, localized, no reflex change, no muscle wasting, and electrophysiologically largest clusters of spontaneous activity with no other abnormality in the baseline electromyography. Whereas pathological twitching, so now you found twitching, we want to know whether it is physiological or pathological. So pathological one, it will be widespread, not localized. At least in the initial stage, it is objective than subjective. Some examiner or some doctor will show it, are you not having this? Then only patient becomes sensitive, then they come and tell, I got it there. So it is more objective than subjective, more widespread. Usually there is wasting or reflex change, and electrophysiologically the spontaneous activity is in smaller clusters, less than 4, and baseline EMG will be abnormal. So abnormal EMG with smaller clusters is pathological, wasted limb, objective than subjective, and more widespread. So in this patient, only thing you told, it is subjective, but somebody has already diagnosed motor neuron disease for him. So they would have told him, you are having this. So it's most likely somebody observed it and told him. Second, he is having a wasted limb. Other changes, we have to wait and see. Electrophysiology, we are not done. So this is definitely pathological. So one is a wasting. The wasting is the distribution of the ulnar nerve apparently. When we examine, is it going to be more widespread? We don't know. Second, your iron fasciculations. Fasciculations can be happening even in ulnar nerve or in root involvement, CAD1 root involvement. Generally, they will be in the distribution of the nerve or the root if it is a radiculopathy or a neuropathy. If it is due to anterior horn cell disease, it will be more widespread. So fasciculations, even though they are very much pathognomic of anterior horn cell involvement, it is not against the diagnosis of a nerve or a root. It can happen, but only thing, it will be localized to the nerve or the root distribution if it is nerve or root involvement. Whereas it will be more widespread in anterior horn cells. So fasciculations by themselves is not excluding or confirming. You will have to find out the distribution of the fasciculation. You may have silent fasciculations also. Patient may not complain, and in those areas also you might find fasciculations. And you know the L-escoral criteria of anterior horn cell disease diagnosis, clinically definite and laboratory proved definite, clinically probable and laboratory proved probable. Those criteria are there. That means you find three locations, LMN three and EMN on the same territory. For example, you may have a brisk jerks and you may have muscle wasting, and two locations is probable, clinically probable. Laboratory proved definite is you find clinical features supported by EMG evidence of widespread fasciculations with baseline denervation pattern. Whereas laboratory proved possible is you are not finding, you are finding the electrophysiological features not in the location where EMN is already. Electrophysiological features of LMN in the area where there is EMN is definite. Where it is EMN is not definite is possible. So the criteria will be L-escoral criteria, definite, clinically definite is three locations, LMN, EMN. Clinically possible is two locations. Laboratory proof will be you love your EMG evidence of denervation in areas where there is EMN involvement, and where there is not much EMN involvement is possible. So those things you will have to explain, apply, then only we will know whether it's a nerve, because fasciculation as such, it doesn't exclude a nerve involvement. But if the fasciculations were seen on the medial lateral side also, or fasciculations were seen in the upper arm, fasciculations were seen in thighs. Usually fasciculations are very much seen in the thighs and bulkier muscles. So if that is there, like proximal patient has experienced, that is a point that it is not localized to the ulnar distribution, it is more widespread. The patient is unable to tell, we'll have to wait. Usually triceps quadriceps and proximal bulkier muscles like deltoid, it is becoming more obvious. It will be more obvious. So we'll keep, we have fasciculations, you have got muscle wasting, you have got partial clawing. Then does he have any, you said that he's not having any autonomic features. So syringomyelia and other intrinsic cord problems, clinically it is not supported. And another thing you will have to ask, whether he is having any cold perisis. During exposure to cold, is there any aggravation of the neurological symptom? Does he have any tremors? So usually, if it is an anterior disease of distal type, you know, you have got in the upper limb, you have got phloem syndrome, you have got Hirayama variety, and you have got Gauri Devi Madam syndrome. So many syndromes are there. So Gauri Devi Madam syndrome is one hand. When it is both hands, we call it as Hirayama, Japanese. Phloem is proximal. They are all variants. And you have got Mills variant, which is hemiplegic variant. That's one upper limb and one lower limb. So the upper limb with ipsilateral lower limb involvement becomes Mills variant. Upper limb, one upper limb distal is Gauri Devi Madam's. Both upper limbs is Hirayama. Then proximal upper limb is fly limb. Distal lower limb is Chopra's wasted leg syndrome. So in the lower limb, the focal antihonsil prefers the distal one. In the upper limb, the classical focal type is the phloem syndrome, which is proximal. Whereas the distal one is the Hirayama if it is bilateral. And if it is unilateral, you call it as Gauri Devi Madam syndrome. And then we have got the variant types, the Madras motor neuron disease, where also you get distal wasting. And you have got the various types of ALS, which can start in one side and later produce widespread involvement. But cold perisis is supposed to be one unique feature in Hirayama variety. So whether the patient has worsening of symptoms on exposure to cold in a condition like this, even though it is like an ulnar, no? Some features are little atypical. If it is an ulnar neuropathy due to Hansen's disease, by 4 years, he should have developed a little more features of obvious nerve involvement. By sensory, should they have been involved, because pressure palsy, most of them are sensory dominant and motor comes later. Pressure palsy or Hansen or neurofibroma or whatever it is. First thing is sensory, then only motor. Here it is reverse. So you have to be careful, even though apparent distribution described by the patient is respecting a nerve. It may be more than that. Then you will get fasciculatory tremors. They are called pseudo tremors. Pseudo tremors because you have got patchy involvement of the small muscles. There is correct recruitment of agonist, antagonist, synergist is not possible. So when you try to maintain an outstretched posture, the repairing anterior motor units, when one motor neuron is gone, another motor unit tries to repair it. So the repairing motor unit may be supplying both the agonist and the antagonist. So when you try to maintain a posture, agonist will pull from one side, antagonist will pull from another side, resulting in a tremulousness. We call it as fasciculatory tremors. Or pseudo tremor. It is called pseudo tremor because it is not rhythmic and repetitive. It is arrhythmic because it is due to agonist antagonist pulling from either sides, arrhythmic. So those points you should ask.
He had the fasciculatory tremors. He had.
He has.
Oh. Yeah.
The cold perisis is not there. So these are the points we'll have to ask. Those things are not there. So what else? Yes, that's all. Twitching.
Twitching and weakness.
That's all. Okay. So what are the other differential diagnosis? You have written some differential diagnosis. Antihonsil disease, as I said, apart from the syringomyelia, this kind of presentation can happen due to thickening of the ligamentum denticulatum. And buckling. Following heavy, it is reported to be seen in people do heavy hard work like drawing water from the well for long time, or injury, or occupational postural abnormality of people who sit with bent neck for long time, there is a thickening of the ligamentum dendiculatum. So the buckling of the ligament can be demonstrated, and there is a surgical correction for that. So that we should not forget. And then pseudo-syringomyelic conditions, where apparently it will be motor, but when we examine, you might find sensory pseudo-syringomyelic presentation or cervical compressive myelopathies because of the ischemia, cord ischemia. Sulco-commissural artery supply the medial pyramidal fibers, crossing spinothalamic and ventral horns. So if the ventral horns are affected, you can get syringomyelia or MND-like picture. Syringomyelia-like picture will be seen when you examine. Sensory may be there when you examine. Otherwise, it will look like MND. You label it as MND, but it may be treatable. So treatable ones will be ligamentum dendiculatum buckling. Second, it may be pseudo-syringomyelic presentation of a compressive myelopathy. Then intrinsic cord lesions like granulomatous diseases or even gliomas. Of course, the treatment is not that good, but still you should put it there. You can have Arnold Chiari malformations, which can be silent and become, he's a relatively young person. And then you should know, considering the young age of this person and male gender, do not forget motor neuropathy with multifocal conduction block. So that will be very much resembling antecedent disease. And it will involve the upper limbs. It will involve the forearm muscles, male gender. But it is treatment amenable for immunotherapy, and you'll have to modify the electrophysiology to pick that up. So these are the possibilities. Then when you examine, you will find a motor neuropathy multiple nerve pattern only. Apparently, we are getting a nerve pattern in this case. So that nerve pattern will be favoring that. It will be purely motor, and reflexes are usually depressed. Male gender of fourth decade, all those things favoring this motor neuropathy multiple. Only when we do the nerve conduction, you will find nerve conduction is prolonged, and you will find multiple conduction blocks. That is, amplitude of the motor evoked potential will be more than 50% reduced in two different points. That is called conduction block. So there will be a conduction flow block, delayed conduction velocity. But it will be respecting nerves. It will be purely motor, easily amenable to treatment. Then another upper limb variant in an Kennedy's type of SMA. It is a trinucleotide expansion disorder, spinobulbar atrophy with gynecomastia, testicular atrophy, male gender. We call it as Kennedy's syndrome. So these are the differential diagnosis we will keep in our mind. And then we will examine. We'll examine. He's thin person, huh?
Thin person. Patient is the
conscious copy. Having any immune compromise situation, no?
No, madam. No apparent immunocompromise.
Yes, he's a...
In 21.
Okay, low BMI.
No parallel rectus, kinosis clubbing, lymphadenopathy are ready. BP, there is no orthostatic change. Pulse is 74 beats per minute, which is regular. Normal volume character with no radial delay or femoral delay. Peripheral pulses being well fit and equally. Respiratory rate is normal, abdominal thoracic in nature, normal saturation and temperature. Neck length ratio is less than 13. There is no rashes, hypopigmented or anesthetic patches. There is no nerve thickening. No any connective tissue features like thickening of the skin, livedo reticularis, rashes. There is no Horner syndrome on examination. Cranial nerve examination, higher mental function, patient is conscious, oriented to time, place and person. Speech, language and memory is normal. Cranial nerves, they're all normal. Tongue, there is no fasciculations.
Anybody with a cervical-like lesion, cranial nerves?
Lower cranial nerve.
lower cranialness, you should look for corners, for perioral, preoral type of bulbar involvement, sensory features, that inverted
balaclava.
Forward sensory loss, spinal tract of trigeminal can be involved. So you can have a forward sensory impairment. Specifically, if you don't look, you might miss it. We have seen patients labeled as MND with a very obvious EVG anomalies. Long time labeled MND and going on. We have seen that. It's very sad sometimes, no? With tongue atrophy, so much symptoms we have seen. So forward sensory loss, you'll have to elicit. And papilledema, because some patients having a spinal arachnoiditis, high CSF protein, Freund syndrome, tumors. So spinal cord with papilledema, spinal cord with optic atrophy. Optic atrophy there means it is going to point to this B12 toxic. So toxic myeloneuropathies. So if you have toxin induced spinal cord syndromes, you might find optic atrophy. You might find papilledema if there is an arachnoiditis or high protein situation, especially this person has low body weight and high risk behavior. They are missing something which can be reversed. Then we should not forget to look for the trigeminal and the lower cranial nerves. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Then go.
The left hand, when you're trying to, the weakness of small muscles of the hand in the left hand.
So what is this movement he is doing with the thumb now?
Flexion.
Going into flexion. Yes. Adduction and abduction, how is it done? You'll be asked, no, what are all the thumb movements you do, no? Adduction and abduction is done perpendicular to the plane of the palm, whereas flexion and extension is along the plane of the palm. So flexion, extension is along the plane of the palm. Adduction and abduction is perpendicular to the plane of the palm. So now he is doing flexion and extension. Agreed? Can you do abduction?
When you abduction is weak, we can do, but it is weak compared to the right side. It is reduced.
Okay. Symptomatic thing was the small little finger on the right finger, but you find that the thumb is also involved, no? Symptomatic was the little on the ring finger. First symptom was.
Yes, okay.
Then show the partial cloy, the first dorsal introsti. First dorsal introsti is very much wasted. So, how will you check the first dorsal introsti?
Dorsal introsti abduction.
You explain what you are demonstrating. Explain.
This is for opponents that we are checking.
Yes. Opponents is weak. Obviously, weak.
For dorsal introsti, dorsal introsti is involved in abduction. So we ask the patient ask him to abduct the fingers and resist the abduction.
So he has a deep wasting of the first dorsal introsti. First dorsal introsti is checked by telling the patient to bring the index finger towards the thumb. Move the index finger towards the thumb. It looks wasted like that. So that is how first dorsal introsti is checked. Then what about the opponents is weak? Then what about the other fingers, ma'am?
Other fingers also.
The little finger and the ring finger, which are symptomatic fingers, is he able to move or it has become completely weak?
He is able to move, ma'am, but photo not to think.
Okay. Forearm wasting is obvious.
Yes,
but it seems to be confined to the medial side and lateral side appears little bulky only.
That oblique type of wasting had of that. I'll just share that.
What?
Is it visible on screen now? Just a second.
I am able to. You tell.
Yes, ma'am.
Right hand, which is fully left hand, is pronated. It is not fully pronated. And then I find that there is a finger drop. There is a partial climb. Obviously, there is a partial climb. And there is a finger drop involving the index finger and the thumb. That is very typical. Finger drop is very typical. You see, so if you describe this outstretched hand, right hand is fully pronated. Left hand is only partially pronated. It is not fully pronated. The extended hand is not fully pronated. And you find a finger drop. Not in this one, the previous picture. Here you can, you saw the, it's a typical finger drop. Finger drop of the index finger and the thumb. And you find partial clawing of the ulnar nerve, the medial two fingers. And the middle finger is standing out. So what is this pattern? We always tell, we described all the nerve and other things, but one typical anterior horncell pattern. So this is a typical anterior horncell pattern. Selection within a zone. You see, if you take the hand and the wrist, it is C7 and C8. C7 is wrist flexion, wrist extension. And finger extension is also C7. All the small muscles are C8, D1. So here you find that there is a finger drop. That means finger extension of the index finger and the thumb is affected. But finger extension, the middle finger is preserved, very much preserved. So that is selection within a territory. Finger drop is very characteristic of anterior horncell involvement. So that you are finding. So the you have to describe that pronator teres is very much. So brachioradial is very well seen. Pronator teres you will have to demonstrate. I don't believe he's pronating only partially in this picture. I think, has he pronated fully or it looks that pronator is not complete. Looks like that apparently. This finger, first dorsal interosseous wasting is obvious. Thumb drop is obvious. Index finger drop is obvious and middle finger extended. That is the typical clue, the clawing. Also pattern is so much not respecting any nerve or anything. Yes. So it is more than a nerve, but less than a root. Within a radicular territory, there is selection. So these two are dropped. This is extended, this is clawed. So this is a typical hand of a anterior horncell. We call it a selection within a territory of a root or a nerve. So it will definitely not a nerve. It is more than a nerve. It is more than a nerve because it is extending to the other areas. But it is not a root because something in that is spared. That's why I told it is sick motor neuron theory of McComas, where a group of motor neurons are there. But all of them do not die. One or two will die. That will produce symptom slowly, slowly. So the one group of motor neurons within that segment may still be alive. That we call it a selection within a group of motor neurons. So one will be sick, one will be, the finger drop is very typical. So it is more than an nerve. Clinically, we thought it is ulnar nerve. It is more than the nerve. But it is less than a root because it is pairing some of them and affecting severely within one radicular territory. Within one radicular territory, even if you take finger drop, thumb drop, is it radial nerve? No, is it anterior interosseous nerve? All those things you can ask questions. But again, there is pairing. Even a radial nerve will not spare this one, no? The middle finger. middle finger is standing like that. So finger drop with wrist drop will be radial nerve. Finger drop without wrist drop will be anterior interosseous, yeah. Posterior interosseous nerve. But it is neither posterior interosseous nerve is respected, nor radial nerve is respected. Instead, there is drop of two fingers and sparing of another finger which is coming within the radial nerve distribution. It is more than ulnar nerve. Is it ulnar plus radial is the next question. Is it ulnar nerve plus radial nerve? Motor neuropathy with multifocal conduction block, if you are considering, whether it is ulnar nerve plus radial nerve is involved. That's the next question. So you think of the radial nerve. Radial nerve, classical radial nerve will produce wrist drop with finger drop. Here you have got partial wrist drop, but finger drop is sparing the middle finger. So it is not typical of radial nerve. Is it posterior interosseous nerve? Posterior interosseous nerve is, it will spare the wrist. It will be finger drop without wrist drop. Where you have got wrist drop. So it is neither fitting into radial nerve nor fitting into posterior interosseous nerve. So it is not a motor neuropathy with multifocal contraction block clinically. Electrophysiologically, still you should investigate for treatable causes. So still in this case, you should look for motor neuropathy with multifocal contraction block and thickening of the ligamentum, denticulatum, all those things you should definitely look for. So you found this pattern, then did you find any other area, silent area showing wasting or fasciculation? Which patient is not symptomatic, but did he have fasciculations anywhere else or wasting anywhere else?
In this entire process while examining, like we examined for around one hour, this entire process, there was no fasciculation at all in the center. We tried inducing fasciculation, tapping, but there was no objective. We could not find any fasciculation.
What are methods you tried?
One was tapping.
Did you? Hyperventilation.
We did, madam. It's we not didn't enough. Have anything.
Oh, but he is complaining, no?
He was saying that it is there, but
any wasting anywhere else?
No, only this limb there is wasting. No other place there is any wasting.
Okay. Sensations, reflexes?
Reflexes were preserved. Here it was diminished. In the brachial radialis was absent. Supinator jerk was absent in the left side. Whereas all the other, this one was 1+. Reflexes. Lower limb were normal, then there was no...
Reflexes preserved or exaggerated means it is going in favor of an interventional disease with upper motor involvement. But other conditions, reflexes can be either normal or depressed or both can happen. So it is depressed, okay then. This typical hand is an interventional pattern. It is not radial nerve, it is not ulnar nerve, it is not respecting any of them. Okay. Then.
And one doubt is, when we're mentioning small muscles, should we say power or should we say just weak and should we leave it?
Small muscles, you need not grade it.
Okay.
It is not possible to grade because you will have to use your small muscles only to grade a person's small muscles. Need not grade. You can just
say weak and... Lower limb was normal, superficial and deep tendon reflexes. It was depressed in the left side. Sensory was normal. He was saying occasionally there was mild hyperesthesia. In fact, when you are checking temperature, especially in this ulnar nerve, C7, C8, hyper. And T1.
Hyper, no?
Not hyper. Ready. He was saying hyper. 10% increase, he was saying. But it was not very much demonstrable, like very minimal.
When you tap the muscle and elicit fasciculation, what function you are using is increased myotactic irritability. When the muscle fiber is denervated, it is irritable. So when you tap it and elicit, you are using the phenomenon of myotactic irritability. When you do hyperventilation, ionic calcium becomes reduced. So when the ionic calcium becomes reduced, it is like a tetany. So this anterior affected limb will be more prone for tetanic process. So you are doing hyperventilation to reduce ionic calcium and induce tetany. That will be more obvious in a person who is already having interventional disease. And when you are tapping, you are using the property of increased myotatic irritability. Sometimes olden days when electrophysiology was not available for everybody, people used to tell you can give a small dose of cholinergic drug like neostigmine. So when you give a small dose of cholinergic drug, the twitching will be unmasked in the affected area much more than normal people can twitch if you give an IV neostigmine injection. Whereas these people in a small dose only, they will start twitching. So these are the three methods. So these are usual your exam questions. So here you could tell that even though motor neuropathy multifocal conduction block is a very strong possibility, it is not respecting either an ulnar nerve or radial nerve. There is a wrist drop, there is a finger drop, there is a cloy. So both can be put into ulnar nerve, but sensory is not at all affected. And there is middle finger standing out. So this is not respecting a nerve pattern. So clinically not possible. But typical anterior-onset-like presentation can happen with a buckling of ligamentum denticulatum. So you will examine, definitely you will investigate the case. You will do the nerve conduction also. So those things you will have to tell. This pattern, okay. Then electrophysiology and all was not done, no?
Done, madam. Nerve conduction study showed motor axonopathy of...
low amplitude.
Low amplitude was there.
Okay.
And in electromyography, EMG was suggestive of neurogenic pattern.
Okay. What is neurogenic pattern?
Don't know.
When you do the EMG, you will find increased insertional activity. Normally, when you put in the needle, there will be few discharges that will go off within few seconds. But it remains longer for more than 30 seconds. Then second, you find spontaneous activity. Then you do the minimum voluntary activity, you find large amplitude polyphasic potentials, which are giants, and reduced recruitment. In between complexes, there will be a lot of space. That is called reduced recruitment because motor unit size is big, but motor unit number is less. When one motor neuron is dead, the neighboring motor neurons go and innervate. So one motor neuron, which is normal, will be supplying more number of muscle fibers. So that is a motor unit. So large motor units are manifested as polyphasic giant potentials. But the motor unit number is less. So in between complexes, there will be space. Recruitment is reduced. So that is the thing. So axonopathy means low amplitude. Low amplitude what you see in terminal axon becomes sick due to reduced axoplasmic flow, so low amplitude complexes. So nerve conduction velocity, they were told, motor nerve conduction, CMI papillae normal, bilateral median normal. So motor conduction velocity is normal. Absent of motor action potential ulnar nerve distribution may be due to 4 years duration and very much muscle fibers are lost, means you'll not get anything. And the muscle fibers are completely gone. MRI, let me see.
What you find
in the MRI, ma'am? You find that?
This is flexion, full flexion MRI.
Yes.
T1. T1 sequence.
Yes.
Where it is showing this.
What you are seeing? Describe. You are finding cord atrophy. Cord atrophy is seen between C4 to cord atrophy is seen from C4 to downwards, and there is mild hyperintensity in the ventral and the dorsal ventral part of the high cervical region and the dorsal part below C3. You will find mild hyperintensity. You go to other sequences are there, huh?
Are there.
T2. So that is only CSF. That what you are seeing is CSF. This is CSF. So what you find is a cord atrophy. Mild localized cord atrophy. C2, C3, C4, C5, C6, C7 region, you find mild thinning of the cord. That's all. There is no syrinx. There is no extra-axial compression. Axial cuts are there. The axial cuts, you might find something called cobra eye sign. Cobra eye sign, because the corticospinal tracts get degenerated. So what is the difference between Hirayama and the Flylom syndrome? Flylom syndrome is proximal. That's a variant part of MND only. It is proximal. And Hirayama is distal.
Distal, bilateral and symmetric.
And generally, Hirayama syndrome has a very less chance of becoming generalized ALS-like. Whereas Flylom, so very small percentage. It will be confined to the distal. It can affect the opposite side. But usually distal, cold paresis will be there, tremors will be there. But progressive motor neuron disease involving the rest, which are very fatal, is less common. Whereas Flylom syndrome, small percentage over a period of time can progress to involve the other muscles. But it is less than 20%. So Flylom is proximal, Hirayama is distal. Gauridevi madam syndrome is unilateral distal, whereas bilateral distal is Hirayama. Second, cold paresis is not there in the Flylom syndrome, whereas cold paresis is there in the Hirayama. Cord atrophy is seen in Hirayama, whereas you might find buckling of ligament and dendriculatum or intrinsic cord signal changes if it is pseudosyringomyelic presentation of compressive cord, or you might find cavitary lesions or mass lesions if it is a cord, intrinsic cord pathology presenting with a small muscle vesicle. So that is what. So what is the role of Riluzole in this case, ma'am? You said that you tried Riluzole, no? So we say that there are so many pathomechanisms, wide spectrum anterior cell disease. It can be familial, non-familial. It can be various phenotypes, you know, that purely EMN, purely LMN, LMN plus EMN. All those conditions are there and the restricted forms. Only one thing you should never forget is the bulbar type, which is a riboflavinopathy, high-dose riboflavin. So treatable forms, apart from all those things which we discussed as a treatable form, if we now come back to the anterior disease as such, never forget the riboflavinopathies, the bulbar, younger onset, high-dose riboflavin is helpful for them. That we should not forget. Otherwise, we have treatment options are based on the pathogenesis. Genetics are there. You have got superoxide dismutase. So there is an oxidative stress. So superoxide dismutase gene abnormality, there is an oxidative stress. Then you have got other proteins like alsin, synotaxin, TDP43. That why you understand, supposing somebody presents with an Andermann cell disease and he is carrying the TDP43. You can say that over a period of time, he may develop a frontotemporal dementia. So the overlap syndrome start with benign MND like picture and they progress. So prognostication, supposing you find TDP43 in a person who presents like this, over a period of time, he is going to develop behavioral issues and he's already having some hypersexual behavior, no? So whether the frontal lobe is involved and the long-term prognosis is very bad. Whereas the classical Hirayama, long-term prognosis, bad hands, but otherwise he will go on. So that is the role of genetics. Superoxide dismutase deficiency, if you demonstrate, you give antioxidants, but doesn't help that much. Riluzole is based on that only. It is so that other antioxidants are also used, but classical superoxide dismutase is diaphragm onset, family history. So they present with orthopnea, paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea because of the diaphragmatic weakness. they can have ocular involvement. Ocular involvement is very uncommon in MND, but superoxide dismutase, there may be ocular involvement. TDP43, some behavioral changes may be there. They may be obstinate, people, arrogant, egoistic. We will think it's a personality disorder. They may slowly evolve into a frontal lobe syndrome. That is TDP43. All since sinotaxin or various types of Andermann cell types only. You know that there are some 8 types of genes involved in the classical ALS. So all these proteins, they are not specific. So that is one, oxidative stress. Second hypothesis people test, glutamate excitotoxicity. So anti-excitotoxin. And oxidative stress, you give antioxidants. Glutamate excitotoxicity hypothesis, based on that, we give riluzole. Riluzole is an anti-excitotoxin. So riluzole is useful only in those conditions, and that too not for this kind of benign conditions, a very distal muscle weakness. Riluzole is supposed to delay the ventilatory stage of the patient by 3 months. So when there is a respiratory involvement, the respiratory muscle putting the patient on ventilation can be delayed by 3 months. So riluzole is used based on this glutamate excitotoxicity. And some people have found slow virus. Slow virus hypothesis came from progressive post-polio syndrome. Supposing you got poliomyelitis of one leg. And after, it was postulated that over a period of time, 2-3 decades later, these people had more incidence of Andermann cell disease in uninvolved sites. Previously uninvolved site, left lower limb is involved with polio. After 20 years, you develop right upper limb weakness. So that is a progressive post-polio syndrome led to the slow virus hypothesis. So polio virus might remain dormant and infect other areas slowly based on that antiviral agents like amantadine hydrochloride. So the drugs used in motor neuron disease are based on various hypotheses. Next group of drugs, people found that there was, by post-mortem examination of the spinal cord, there was inflammatory change. So these are the four. One is genetic, that may be all since sinotoxin, superoxide dismutase, TDP43, all those things, genetics. All patterns, dominant, recessive, X-linked is the Kennedy's type. All patterns are there. Then you have got the glutamate excitotoxicity based on the riluzole issue, slow virus hypothesis, low antiviral agents. Postmortem inflammatory change was introduced first by Gauri Devi madam. She popularized the use of cyclophosphamide. Later, people tried IVIG. But we don't know, there was no sustained effect. But every time you give a cyclophosphamide option, people say that they are better. You know, for some time, subjective feeling of betterness, I think that when somebody has told them you have a waste paper disease, and you give some IV fluid along with cyclophosphamide, he feels some option is there. But there was no sustained effect. We have not seen that. And now newer neuroprotective agents are used. That also I have not found it showing any use. I have not seen any use in any of these patients which are used in strokes now. So they are used, but I have not found it useful. Symptom management. So you can preserve the bulk by physiotherapy. And fasciculations, you have no treatment. Cramps, you can give some vitamin E, and you can give mechanical supports for foot drop and other things which can happen in some of these patients. Overall, it is all a multidisciplinary approach to maintain the morale of the patient. But if you are sure it is Hirayama, it is not showing anything else anywhere else, you can reassure that the course is going to be benign. So the hand is very typical. You'll have to describe the ulnar nerve, the radial nerve, CAD1 root, tell the points for, points against, and say that's a typical anterior horn cell pattern. So good, it's a nice case, but a short case, I think. CPK moderate elevation. So supposing you did the CPK after EMG or some intramuscular injection or some physiotherapy, this mild elevation can happen. So you can give him rest and repeat after some time. Anything else? Okay.
Overall, prognosis will be good because it will be static after some.
Yes. So 4 years he has not spread anywhere. What I think that hand is a spotter. It's not a short case also. It's a spotter case. If you see the case. Spotter case, you will have to describe olden days we used to have ward rounds in Madras University. Now DNB is having ward rounds. MD is not having ward rounds, I think. MD is having ward rounds. Huh? So ward rounds is you show the hand. Do one test and tell me is it radial. No? So you see the wrist drop, you see the finger drop. So you should do one test. What is the radial nerve or not? One test and say it's radial nerve. This is one test only. Ward rounds is one test. So the middle finger is extended and the ulnar nerve is clawed. That never happens with radial nerve. It's not radial nerve. So one question, one answer, spotter. So tongue, lmn, umn. So common peroneal nerve versus sciatic nerve. You look at the angle jerk. So like that. That helps the examiner to know how much you have worked at the bedside. So this is a ward round spotter case to differentiate radial nerve from radial nerve palsy from CAD1 root and ulnar nerve alone. So the classical features you will have to describe. It's a very typical, very nice hand. Okay. Thank you. Any question, ma'am?
I'll just give it.
I'm not seeing any question.
One question is there on YouTube. How to DM postgraduates from Madras Medical Colleges, Ash.
Yes,
cold paresis can also be seen in MMN with conduction block.
Yes.
How to differentiate between Hirayama and MMN since both are slowly progressive?
The electrophysiologically, one thing, the pattern. You see, here I told this pattern is anterior horncell pattern. Anterior horncell pattern is selection within an anterior horncell territory or selection within a nerve territory. Classically, we thought it is showing selection. Radial nerve means the wrist drop with finger drop. We saw the finger is extended. So it is not radial nerve. If it is ulnar nerve, you find a partial clawing, but others are in. Also, it's more than ulnar nerve. It is less than radial nerve. That is typical of, and you do the electrophysiology, you have found all the, there is no conduction block, there is no normal nerve conduction except that low amplitude complexes. So that is the way you differentiate. Of course, you have to consider motor neuropathy with multifocal conduction block, but it has been clearly proved in this case, both clinically and electrophysiologically, it is not motor neuropathy with multifocal conduction block.
One more question, same person has asked. Can you explain how ligamentum denticulatum thickening can cause weakness?
It is like the pseudo syringomyelic presentation, or either by the it is compressing on the root exit zones. Both ways it can do. Pseudo syringomyelic presentation is ischemia to the medial. We have got three areas which are vulnerable for ischemia by compression. One is the ventral horn, crossing spinothalamic and medial pyramidal. So when the ventral sulcocommissural artery, because of the peculiarity of the arterial supply of the spinal cord, so if the sulcocommissural artery becomes ischemic, it will look like an anterior horncell disease. So that way, thickening of the ligament and discolation is anyway, it's a compressive myelopathy. That compressive myelopathy blocking, producing an ischemic component. That is one mechanism. Second is radical involvement. So either by radicular involvement or by cord ischemia, you can mimic an anterior horncell disease. But even then, I have not found so many cases we are operated at NIMHANS. But I thought that young people, they get a huge surgery and they later go into post-laminectomy syndromes, or they go into canal stenosis due to manipulation of the natural barriers in the spinal cord rather than improvement. I cannot say that radial, because for the purpose of study, you do some 1 grade, 2 grade, but whether there is an useful improvement, we don't know. But longitudinal follow-up, some of these patients after some years, these are generally young people, because we are meddled with a cord, they go into healing process and canal stenosis more often than people of their age group. Meddling the cord over a period of time, you know that post-laminectomy membranes and all those things happen. So this is more. So or longitudinally, some of them become more sick. Significant improvement I have really not seen, but people have published saying that some scores. So when you apply scores, many parameters are used. So you have to go to the patient and see. So I am not convinced that it is that much helpful. It is my personal opinion. I am not a surgeon. I have not operated. I cannot tell. But I have seen the patients longitudinally. Some of them become more hospital birds, repeated visits for so many complaints. Any other
question? One question is, can we expect SMA in this case?
Definitely not. Distal SMA, you want to say? No, I am not thinking SMA at all in this case. Distal SMA is much more younger, bilateral. You have got distal SMA of the upper limb type. You have got the lower limb type. So many types are there. But it is focal, long period of asymmetry. I am not thinking it is distal SMA. Distal SMA is a symmetrical disease, more symmetrical disease.
One more question is the mechanism of cold paresis causing weakness.
Cold paresis, you have got these ion channels, no? So many hypotheses, exact mechanism, nobody knows. But you know that when the temperature, when you do electrophysiology, you have to maintain the temperature. Because temperature influences conduction. And that is supposed to be due to voltage-gated calcium channels. So when there is a disease, there is an apparent change in the voltage-gated calcium channels. That is the hypothesis. The temperature-induced changes become altered. Like you see that warmth can increase weakness in multiple sclerosis. That's also temperature-induced apparent changes in the voltage-gated calcium channels. So such kind of changes in the voltage-gated channels result in cold paresis. Apparent response to thermal changes in the ion channels. Apparent response to temperature changes in the ion channels.
That is the end of question.
Yeah. Any other question?
Suppose like this kind of like typical intervencial hand or something is not there.
Which one, ma?
Like, suppose the patient is not having typical hand presentation like intervencial disease. Hmm. That time it would be based on conduction tests and
imaging
that we'll get the diagnosis.
Yes.
How common is like Hiraya Mogam like in practice?
I cannot say that I have seen many cases. I think I would have, in my 3 decades of neurology, I think I would have seen some 5-6 cases. Only classical with bilateral involvement, cold paresis. This also, I will not like to call it as Hiraya
Mogam.
Because it is only one limb now. Here is bilateral. Cold paresis is not there. Tremors are there and remains. So you can call it as a focal distal variant of intervention disease, benign variants. Mm-hmm. Any other question? No.
No, ma'am. No other questions.
Then we'll close.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, madam.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you.